To some people, he is the savior of millions of refugees. To others, a cold technocrat of war. To the victors, he was, above all, a war criminal.
Dem Allmächtigen und Allwissenden.
I will speak the pure truth.
Dass ich die reine Wahrheit sage.
And he was good. And he had nothing.
Und nichts verschweigen.
You sit down.
A man of conviction.
Ich halte diese Kriegführung für berechtigt und habe nach meinem Gewissen gehandelt. Ich möchte das genauso wieder tun.
Berlin at the turn of the century. The bourgeoisie was loyal to Kaiser and Fatherland, as was the Dönitz family. Karl Dönitz's mother died young. His father brought up the two sons on his own. Duty and obedience were the highest imperatives. Personal happiness was of secondary importance. Karl was considered reserved but talented. He wanted to be an officer in the Navy. The Imperial Fleet, the pride and joy of an adolescent nation. The Naval Academy at Flensburg, Mürwik. Here, Karl Dönitz's career both began and ended. He enlisted in 1910. 2 years later, his father died, and he lost his only support in life. The young cadet yearned for a replacement. Then Lieutenant Commander von Löwenfeld took him on board and became his idol and mentor. The First World War. Dönitz was considered a brave fighter. He fell in love and married soon afterwards, all part of his longing for security. His second great love, a new weapon. U-boats, the last trump card. They promised glory and the hope of victory. But in the end, the whole fleet was forced to surrender. Dönitz was in British hands when he learnt of Germany's defeat and the fall of the monarchy. Anarchy in the Reich. A world collapsed, not only for Dönitz. A mutiny by sailors, of all people, sparked off the revolution. It was traumatic to Dönitz. The returned sailor hated the new Weimar Republic under the moderate socialist Ebert. He missed the old rule. He felt unnerved by the new freedom. Nonetheless, he entered the Reich Navy. He was serving the state, not a particular government. In the Kapp Putsch of 1920, insurgent soldiers tried to overturn the unpopular republic. Dönitz secretly hoped they would succeed, but in vain. Everyday life between the two wars, he commanded torpedo boats. Naval Chief Raeder didn't like Dönitz. He described him as clever and hard-working, but on a disapproving note, he reported Dönitz hankered after recognition and was very ambitious. The economic misery of the Weimar Republic's years of crisis also affected the Dönitz family. By now, they had three children.
From the 20th of the month on, all we got was gruel, or soup, or something like that. But it must be said that my mother was not a very good housekeeper. But things were always scarce then.
One man used all this hardship to pick up votes. He seduced the people with promises of strong leadership, the restoration of order, and the end of chaos. A clear message to Dönitz as well. And so Hitler slipped into power. Dönitz welcomed it as a fresh start for Germany. At last, someone who meant business.
Ich habe mir ein Ziel gesteckt, nämlich die 30 Parteien aus Deutschland hinauszubringen.
Anyone who got in the way was disposed of. Order through terror. The Navy submitted unconditionally to the new head of state. Like all military men, the ambitious naval officer Dönitz swore a personal oath of loyalty to Hitler. Hitler valued the expert knowledge of his specialist and ordered a new arsenal of U-boats. Starting from scratch, Dönitz was to give Hitler supremacy under the water. With zeal and determination, he worked beyond the call of duty.
It was said that he appeared the following morning and outlined a clear concept for building, developing, and testing the U-boat force. The ability to grasp a situation quickly and make a decision was a trademark of his.
More than submarines, Hitler really wanted big battleships. Dönitz looked on with suspicion. He thought giant ships like the Bismarck were superseded and vulnerable. Great Britain, a defiant island. Dönitz maintained that only U-boats could cut her crucial lines of supply and starve out their enemy of past and future. His words fell on deaf ears. He didn't belong to the inner circle yet. The Navy had the privilege of opening the Second World War. Dönitz was horrified, but not from a love of peace. Britain was far superior at sea, and he had only 56 U-boats, despite his demands for 300.
He withdrew and returned in half an hour, having regained his composure. That was typical of him. He composed himself. He swallowed it, so to speak, and then he said, "We'll just have to make the best of a hopeless situation." For us sailors, a war with England was quite a hopeless business.
Such fears had to be pushed under. An attack on the very first day of war. The commander of the U-30 torpedoed the British passenger ship Athenia without warning. 112 people died. Pictures of the survivors were seen all over the world and kindled hatred of Dönitz's men. Dönitz had the order to sink the ship removed from the U-30's war log. A visitor to Wilhelmshaven. When Hitler came to inspect Dönitz's men, the U-boat commander seized the opportunity to press his demands for what he had been so far denied, more boats. But Hitler still thought the war at sea was of secondary importance. Dönitz was frustrated. U-boat production was going slowly, a mere 2 submarines per month. They had to come up with a stroke of brilliance. October 1939, Lieutenant Commander Preen was hunting the enemy. A piece of astonishing bravado from U-47. Her commander penetrated the British Royal Navy's sanctuary at Scapa Flow and sank the battleship Royal Oak. For this, Dönitz was given a hero's welcome in Berlin, as if he were Hitler himself. U-boat victories were good for morale.
Karl Dönitz became one of the best-known figures of the war. I think I first really was aware of him when he sent Gunther Preen in U-47 into Scapa Flow. So that was how, that was first put Karl Dönitz on the map, as far as I was concerned. And then after that, I mean, he appeared in our newspapers all the time. He was as well known as Goering and Goebbels and Ribbentrop and all the rest of them. I mean, he was very well known.
In Britain, Prime Minister Churchill sought safeguards against this new threat. He later admitted, "The only thing that really frightened me during the war was the U-boat peril." What mattered to Hitler was victories on land. France was beaten. The way to the Atlantic ports was open. Dönitz had long dreamed of having bases here. At last, access to the Atlantic. Battle followed battle on the British convoy routes. Now England was to be starved. Tactics of the wolf pack, with several U-boats attacking at the same time. In their home port, a proud chief. And the reward.
The U-boat force was only the size of a small expedition corps. It was nothing, just a handful of people. But they were wonderfully suited to propaganda. First, sailors in dress uniform look pretty good. And secondly, you could create a legend around the U-boat. No wonder U-boat crewmen became favorites with the Führer and with the people too.
But life underwater was not glamorous. It was grim.
The cramped conditions, the stench, and the necessity of doing everything at very close quarters with your comrades imposed a huge and ever-increasing burden on our everyday life.
The hunt was on. British bombs against German U-boats.
We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
A merciless duel. of weapons and words. London in flames. While Goering's Air Force tried to subdue London, the British Admiralty took shelter in a bunker, the Citadel. Here there was an atmosphere of crisis. Losses were increasing rapidly. Over 10,000 sailors had already been killed. Suffocated in the oil of their sinking ships, dead of thirst in the watery wasteland. Dead from exhaustion. Or burnt to death just before help arrived. In the mill at Rosmerdijk, German U-boat men celebrated their victories with their elated chief. They drank to their spoils and their own survival.
Yeah.
We drove to Pont-Aven and celebrated and ate oysters and lobster and drank champagne. And then, we were still young, when we came home with flags on the periscope, of course, we celebrated.
Dönitz had gigantic pens built for his U-boats. Concrete roofs, several meters thick, protected them from the Royal Air Force. The bunkers at Lorient alone cost over 400 million Reichsmarks. The U-boat war soon reached its limits. Dönitz repeatedly asked Goering for help from the air and for more Navy pilots. But the Reich Marshal refused. To keep up his men's spirits, Dönitz resorted to unusual methods. Here, the chief is playing himself in the film U-Boats Westwards.
Kämpfen heißt opfern und siegen.
He was no speech maker or rhetorician. He hadn't learned how to make speeches. They were always extremely simple. They appealed to the people who were around him. I was able to observe how he spoke to the troops. A commander does not normally call his men together and make propaganda speeches like Goebbels, gesticulating wildly as if a puppeteer had gotten all of his strings crossed.
Bombs hit the U-110. The submarine was forced to surface and was boarded. It offered rich booty. Enigma, the key to the Wehrmacht's secret code. This machine let British codebreakers into everything Dönitz and his commanders discussed over the radio.
What happened, therefore, is that we read every one of those signals, and almost every convoy was sent away from the U-boat pack. And the defeat of the U-boats was not so much a defeat as the avoidance of any successes. They had to say, We cannot find convoys.
The Germans knew nothing of this breach of security, which was to decide the battle of the Atlantic. The enemy was listening, and no one suspected. Dönitz's U-boats tracked down British convoys more and more rarely. It wasn't until the 1970s that the truth came to light. A new enemy, the United States, U-boats off New York. Operation Drumbeat began on January the 12th, 1942. Torpedoing ships off the east coast of the United States was like shooting ducks on a pond for the German submariners. By July 1942, they had sunk 500 ships and their crews. An inferno. Dönitz rewarded his men with medals, with grand words, with home leave, and with presents.
Da stand auf einem Tisch.
On the table in the room stood a sea chest with an open lid. We went over to it unsuspectingly and saw that it was half full of fob watches, all manner of them, with lids and without lids, with Roman numerals and Arabic numerals, red and black, but not one of them had a chain. You have dug around in this pile of watches like a baker with both hands in dough. There must have been hundreds and hundreds. On the lid of the sea chest, there was a medium-sized sign, present from the commander for his U-boat crews. I remember how uneasy and uncomfortable we felt. We couldn't place where these watches came from and suspected more or less that this mass of chainless watches was a sign of lawlessness and violence.
Now he belonged to the inner circle. When Hitler stopped trusting most of his generals, he called for Admiral Karl Dönitz. From then on, he didn't leave his Führer's side. One day later, the German 6th Army surrendered. Stalingrad, the turning point. And the U-boats? Dönitz's voice was finally heard. Hitler's armaments minister Speer gave top priority to the building of new submarines. Concentration camp prisoners were used as dockyard workers, at Dönitz's request. He also had a suggestion of Admiral Fricker's entered into the Naval Command's war records. Fricker wanted ships with Jewish refugees on board torpedoed. The wording is camouflaged. Jewish transports are to be neutralized by methods not commonly used in peacetime. Dönitz knew what was meant.
I was the harbor and camp doctor in the town of Imoiden and a medical officer in a naval air defense unit. Our commander was Hans Erdmann of the Navy Reserve. In Imoiden, we got a visit from Admiral Voss. He was the liaison officer between Navy High Command and the Führer's headquarters. Erdmann told him about what I had heard was happening on the Eastern Front in Germany's name, and said, Voss,
Can't you ask Dönitz to point out these awful things to the Führer? To which Voss replied, Erdmann, we've already tried that. And Dönitz's answer was, I'd never be so foolish as to jeopardize my good relations with the Führer.
Victories pushed aside knowledge of such matters. Once more there was cheering in the home ports. It would be the last time. Then came the catastrophe. The new British detection equipment proved deadly accurate. In the single month of May, 1943, Dönitz lost 41 boats. 2,000 U-boat crewmen died, including Dönitz's son, Peter, and in the following year, his son, Klaus.
I remember that when my eldest brother died in May 1944, when the news reached us, I happened to be staying in Lanka at Koralle. My father came to see me. I was in bed with angina. For a long time, maybe not quite hours on end, we sat there hand in hand and didn't say a word. He just sat there.
An audience at the Berghof. Dönitz broke off from battle, but only briefly. His father had taught him to finish what he had set out to do. The Devil's Admiral. Dönitz was under the spell of the dictator. His faith in Hitler had almost mystical qualities.
The enormous strength radiated by the Führer has shown quite clearly that we are all miserable little creatures compared to him. Anyone who thinks he could do better is stupid.
Here, he was close to Hitler. Koralle, Dönitz's headquarters in the woods near Berlin. From here, he issued orders to hold out to the bitter end. The virtue of being without pity. Even when compassion was asked of him. Blind activity for its own sake. Dönitz ordered the Scharnhorst to attack an Allied convoy. A suicide mission with no chance of success. The German battleship was sunk. 2,000 sailors died.
There were a lot of people in the water. Then they gave a shout of three cheers for the ship and went on to sing the song, On a Sailor's Grave, No Roses Ever Bloom. I saw the ship dip at the bow and then sink very slowly into the sea. Then it grew dark, pitch dark. They couldn't see anything. They just heard the wind and felt the waves. Then I was alone on the water.
Fight to the end. Dönitz was like Hitler in this respect, two of a kind. At issue, the Crimea. The army wanted to withdraw. Dönitz advised they stay. It cost 80,000 men their lives. Hitler and Dönitz, an alliance against reason.
Dönitz was consumed by ambition. He fawned over his Führer at every opportunity. He should have said long before, "Mein Führer, it's all over. We are bankrupt. There's nothing more we can do."
Dönitz, a careerist. Now he was allowed to represent his Führer officially. Memorial Day, 1944.
Was wäre aus unserer Heimat heute, wenn der Führer uns nicht im Nationalsozialismus geeint hätte? Zerrissenen Parteien, durchsetzt von dem auflösenden Gift des Judentums und diesem zugänglich, da die Abwehr unserer jetzigen kompromisslosen Weltanschauung fehlte, wären wir längst der Belastung dieses Krieges erlegen.
After the assassination attempt on his Führer, Dönitz presented himself as a humble vassal prepared to do anything.
Anyone who makes any kind of defeatist remarks must be ruthlessly exterminated. I would sooner eat soil than have my grandchildren brought up and poisoned by the Jewish spirit and filth.
After the war, this memorandum was missing from the files. Only much later was one lone copy discovered, the evidence of murderous lunacy. The Allies in Paris. Their bombers attacked Dönitz's U-boat pens. The submarine war had long been decided in the air. On the home front, Dönitz had smaller implements of war tested. Maritime miracle weapons.
A last desperate but futile attempt. These young men had no naval experience. They had just learned what a compass was. They were virtually children who set out against the enemy and most never returned.
Dönitz himself found reinforcements.
Auf deine Frage, was willst du einmal werden, kommt die Antwort.
U-Boot-Fahrer, Herr Großadmiral.
Und ihr? Einstimmig.
U-Boot-Fahrer, Herr Großadmiral.
In the spring of 1945 alone, almost 8,000 U-boat sailors died. The final battle for Berlin. Shortly before the end, Hitler sent Dönitz to the north of the decaying Reich. The admiral was told to hold the German position there. His destination was Plön. On April the 30th, he received a message from Bormann. Hitler had laid it down in his will that he, Dönitz, was to be his successor. Bormann did not mention Hitler's suicide. Humbly, Dönitz replied to his Führer,
"My loyalty to you is everlasting and unconditional. I shall do everything in my power to relieve you in Berlin."
The capital was surrounded, the Third Reich facing collapse. Dönitz kept his promise. Young Marines were sent to free Hitler. Most of them paid for this insane plan with their lives. On May the 1st, the Admiral learnt of Hitler's death. Now he was the successor.
Deutsche Männer und Frauen, Soldaten der deutschen Wehrmacht. Unser Führer Adolf Hitler ist gefallen. In tiefster Trauer und Ehrfurcht verneigt sich das deutsche Volk. Der Führer hat mich zu seinem Nachfolger bestimmt. Im Bewusstsein der Verantwortung übernehme ich die Führung des deutschen Volkes in dieser schicksalsschweren Stunde.
Wenn ich jetzt Ihre Frage,
if you ask me why he was named successor, I'll answer with another question. Who else was there? Göring, Goebbels, Himmler, Bormann. They were all washed up.
As British tanks pushed forward into Holstein, Dönitz moved the German headquarters from Plön to Flensburg. The Naval Academy at Mürwik, where it all began. Conscientiously, Dönitz set to work on his task, the winding up of the thousand-year Reich. It was in ruins. Destroyed like its people. The new head of state tried to govern.
We arrived in Flensburg and it was utterly peaceful. The weather was nice, it was the beginning of May, and the Navy had posted sailors in white outside. They presented arms when Dönitz or Keitel or Jodl entered the building. It was utterly peaceful and almost unreal.
Dönitz wanted to carry on fighting in the east to save as many Germans as possible from Soviet captivity. Admiral von Friedeburg was given his orders. Play for time and surrender in the west. On the Lüneburg Heath, Field Marshal Montgomery consented to Dönitz's tactics. Montgomery accepted the partial surrender of the Wehrmacht on the 4th of May. The strategy worked. In the end, over 2 million refugees made it to the west. But while he was saving some people, he was executing others. A few young sailors paid for his moral standards with their lives. They had heard about the surrender and in good faith decided to go home.
Dönitz would use the same phrase, and the wording struck me as very interesting. He said, I can't have two moral standards. I can't, on one hand, send my best people to their deaths, and on the other hand, let the cowards go.
Act 2 of the fall of the Reich. Eisenhower's headquarters in Reims. General Jodl's orders were to prevent unconditional surrender spreading to all fronts. He was to string the Allies along with surrender in the west, but continued fighting in the east. Not all the victors would accept this. After conferring with Dönitz, on May the 7th, Jodl agreed to unconditional surrender on all fronts.
Deutsche Männer und Frauen, die Grundlagen, auf denen das Deutsche Reich sich aufbaute.
Wir haben alle einen schweren Weg vor uns. Ich will auf diesem dornenreichen Weg nicht hinter euch zurückbleiben. Gebietet mir die Pflicht, in meinem Amt zu bleiben, dann werde ich versuchen, euch zu helfen, soweit ich irgend kann. Gebietet mir die Pflicht zu gehen, so soll auch dieser Schritt ein Dienst an Stolz und Reich sein.
The Ersatz Hitlers. There wasn't much left for them to do. Dönitz carried on as if nothing had happened. The last absurd state performance. Dönitz's last U-boats surrendered in London. No more playing at government. 2 weeks after the surrender, Hitler's executors were finally forced to step down. Defiance, disappointment, mistrust, arrogance. Arriving for one last pose. The Admiral thought he was in the right. Later, Dönitz was to reproach Speer.
You got me into this. It's all your fault. If it hadn't been for you, Hitler would never have had the idea of making me head of state.
I still think to this day that he himself did not finish with or ever fully come to terms with his relationship to Hitler. In his writings, he rejects the Führer principle, the concept of a totalitarian Führer. But there's nothing which leads me to believe that his relationship with the man, to whom he completely subjugated himself, was laid to rest one way or the other.
After 10 years in Spandau prison, Dönitz was released in October 1956.
In einem Garten in Berlin stellte sich der 65-Jährige zusammen mit seiner Frau den Reportern. Auf ihre Fragen erklärte der ehemalige Oberbefehlshaber der Kriegsmarine, er werde schweigen.